wait for anyone? Are we waiting for anyone? Are we expecting anyone else? Friends, we have organized a distinguished lecture by Dr. Deepankar Shaha, as you know already. And I'll tell you briefly about Dr. Shaha before his talk. He is working in the Central Groundwater Board, which is under the Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Rejuvenation. So this is something new. I didn't know that the name of the ministry has been changed so much. And he's the Member Secretary of the department, looking after research and training, and besides being involved in various committees and task forces under the Government of India. He has about more than 30 years of experience in groundwater investigation, development and management. He did his PhD from Indian School of Mines in groundwater management and a postgraduate diploma in application of remote sensing to groundwater investigations from the Indian Institute of Remote Sensing in Dehradun. He has authored a number of departmental reports, including the state hydrogeological reports of Bihar and Jharkhand, geogenic groundwater contamination in India, and over 35 papers in international peer-reviewed journals. He is professionally trained on applied quaternary geology by Asian Institute of Technology in Bangkok and on integrated water resource management by GICA in JICA in Tokyo. He represented the department in meetings organized by the World Bank in Kathmandu, International Atomic Energy Agency at Ho Chi Minh City in Vietnam, and in Vienna. He has presented papers in the World Water Week in Stockholm. He is the recipient of the National Geoscience Award in 2011 on groundwater exploration, and also the Best Hydrogeologist Award conferred by International Association of Hydrogeologists India Chapter in 2014. Now, Dr. Shaha will be speaking to us. Basically, you have the title here, but it is slightly different. He will be talking in general about geohydrology in general and with particular reference to Bihar, and also focusing on the Nalanda area, which has been his major interest, even in his PhD. So, I will leave the floor to Dr. Shaha. Thank you very much for taking time off. He only could come only on a Saturday. That's why we had to fix it on a Saturday. So you can ask him any questions later on all your queries on water in Nalanda and in the campus in particular. Dr. Shaha, please.
Thank you, sir. Working in Central Groundwater Board. It's a department in the Ministry of Water Resources. Previously it was Ministry of Water Resources, now it is Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Rejuvenation. And I think there are students or professors from different departments other than hardcore groundwater subject. So I'll try to present in a lucid manner. I shall try my best, but I am not a teacher by profession. But you may interrupt at any time, and if you have any question on groundwater issues, the things I am going to explain, you interrupt and ask me, no problem. And these are the photographs of different areas and all the district only, and how to operate them. Yeah. I think everybody is aware about the facts, certain facts about water, that 22% of fresh water remains as groundwater. You see, groundwater is a sort of silent water, so it's not getting its deserved due attention, because surface water, because of big dams, big barrages, big canals, they steal the show. But groundwater, if you see, it's really something else, something throughout the world, particularly in India, I'll tell you. So 22% of fresh water resources groundwater, and you can see that 11% of total groundwater resource is confined within 800 meter below ground, and remaining 11% is 800 meter below ground. You see, the groundwater remains in aquifer in some certain geological formations called an aquifer, which can hold groundwater, which can transmit groundwater, and when you drill a well, you will get water, sufficient volume of water, then only you will turn an aquifer. So this aquifer continues even say in Bihar where you are sitting. I would say that it holds some of the best aquifer in the world, entire world. And in North Bihar, the aquifer may continue even up to 2 km, 2.5 km below ground because of some geological reason. So the aquifer within top 800 meters, 11% of total groundwater resource is there, and below that another 11%. So huge groundwater resource is confined within the aquifers. Now, these are the groundwater resource distribution. There are certain throughout the world to give you an idea how they are distributed worldwide. And more blue means more potential aquifers. You can see this. This is the Indo-Gangetic plain. The Indo-Ganga-Brahmaputra plain is, say, one of the most potential aquifers in the Indian subcontinent. And these blue areas where you can see, they are the good aquifer areas. And here in India, if you, as you are coming south, entering into peninsular India, as the hard rocks are coming, gradually the aquifer potentiality and availability of groundwater is also decreasing. This is the per capita water availability in India. See here how it is declining sharply. This is the water stress line, water scarcity line. And you can see 1951. Our position was and how it is gradually decreasing, and not gradually, it's alarmingly decreasing, I would say. And by 2050, we will be nearing the water scarcity line, and so we need a sustainable and practicable water management plan. Now, in India, the demand of water is sharply increasing. The 2010 is in the demand survey, billion cubic meter, it's 710 million cubic meter. It's expected that it will be 843, and then in 2050, 1180 million cubic meter. So from where this water, huge water will come. And there will be two issues. One is from where we get our additional water, and then another issue is that because of climate change, there will be tremendous pressure on water resource because of the climate variability, and we must increase our water use efficiency also along with regulation. Now if you see the water availability in India, the total precipitation including the snowfall is around 4000 million cubic meter, and this is the annual water availability. But the important factor is utilizable water, that is 1123 billion cubic meter. This is the utilizable water available in India, within the political boundary of India. And out of that, the surface water resource is 690 million cubic meter, and groundwater resource is 433 million cubic meter. This surface water resource and groundwater resource, this groundwater resource of 433 million cubic meter means this resource is recharged every year. So you can use safely this 433 billion cubic meter without any adverse environmental impact. Because if you use this, say you will be emptying your bank account, but you are assured that next month salary will come. I mean to say the next year monsoon will come, again it will be recharged. So our entire groundwater management plan is based on about 430 odd billion cubic meter groundwater availability. Now you can see how much the groundwater is serving our nation. About 75% of rural water supply. Some researchers say more than 75%, getting to 80%. 50% of urban domestic water supply and 60% of irrigation demand. In spite of all big dams, all big canals, barrages and all, the groundwater is carrying 60% of irrigation demand. And urban water supply is very interesting. You are in Nalanda, in Rajgir. Your nearest town is Patna. It's about 30 lakhs population, 3 million population. Entire water is coming from groundwater. And without any serious decline in the water level in the last 20 years. So you can imagine what is the potentiality of aquifer, what is the availability of source water. You see, if aquifer can be potential, but if you extract groundwater in a way more than recharge, then you will be emptying the aquifer, but that is not happening in Patna. So large number of big cities are on the bank of Ganga, they are extracting groundwater for their entire water supply, but still groundwater is available. And in many places, of course, in some places water level is declining rapidly, but in some places water level is not declining, indicating the potentiality of aquifers in the Indo-Gangetic Plain. And this contribution to India's gross domestic product is around 9%. And groundwater irrigation value is in this 20 billion per year. But some researchers again say it is much more, because when you use groundwater, there is a cascading effect. When you use canal water, so you just open the gate and water will come. But when groundwater is used, there will be electrician, there will be a driller, there will be motor mechanic. So many rural employments are also created. So if you annex those, and some economists, sociologists, they are working also in this direction, the value of contribution of groundwater in Indian economy will be much more. And I am not showing you this one table was available with me, I am not putting this slide. India is now officially the largest groundwater extractor in the world. Largest groundwater extractor in the world, surpassing China. So in very few cases we could surpass China. One is groundwater extraction. And if you put China and USA together, even then India's extraction is more than China, groundwater extraction. Besides this economic value, just was tremendous bearing on environment and ecology also, because environment students are also here. You see, the whatever rivers are flowing in the southern part of India or even in the world during non-monsoon period, where glaciers are not contributing, so that is coming ultimately from groundwater. So what the surface water people say, that this is surface water flowing into the river, basically that is groundwater. And in many areas, like in north, we are, if you see, there are large back swamps. They call them TAL, T-A-L, they are basically back swamps, large water body you can see. Not near, particularly in central Bihar. A good example is, you must see, that is Murkama TAL. During monsoon season, you must see, it's like a sea. In North Bihar, in Gangetic Plain, basically they are fed by groundwater. So if the water level, groundwater extraction is in an alarming level, if the water level goes down, all these marshlands will be dried up. And this ecology, biodiversity, they are depending on these to a great extent to these marshlands. So they are intricately related to groundwater. And another interesting factor is, of course, groundwater potential is very high in the Indo-Gangetic Plain, in Bihar, in northern part of Nalanda. But there are problems of groundwater pollution. That is another interesting fact for the environment students, both geogenic and anthropogenic. Geogenic means the groundwater pollution coming from rock water interaction. Groundwater is never static, it always flows. If you peep in your well, you will feel that the water is stagnant in your barrel, but actually that is flowing. So while it flows, it dissolves the minerals from the rock, and certain constituents that increase. So if it increases beyond the limit, we call that contaminated water. So in that way, it will be geogenic, coming from the geology, from the rocks. And anthropogenic is also a concern, but not in Bihar to that extent. It's in UP, like in Kanpur area. It comes basically from the industrial application. They discharge the industrial effluents over ground, and it seeps groundwater and contaminates it. And you may believe that in one of the parliament standing committee on water quality, it revealed that large number of where the animals are butchered, what they call that?
Abattoirs.
They are putting the blood even into the well. A case was there. So when the pollution control board official visited to dupe them, they have put blood into the well, and it immediately entered into the groundwater because the water well is deep. And there, after 3-4 days, all the nearby wells were when they were pumping, the red water was coming, light red. Then somebody could smell God in that. Then a riot-like situation came here, because that was a Hindu-Muslim 50-50 type of population. So a riot-like situation emerged that somebody is killing animal, putting the blood into the groundwater, and then ultimately it revealed that it is coming from the abattoir. So this industrial pollution is a great concern. That is in UP, in West Bengal, in Bihar it is less. Another thing is nitrate pollution, that is coming from the overuse or overdose of fertilizer. That is there in our state, in Bihar, will come in there. And this is a basic slide for those who are not groundwater students, or those who don't know groundwater to a great extent. This is a surface. If you cut a surface, if you dig a well, really like this, these are say all soil, sand, clay, something like that. Now water comes and seeps into, when it enters, we technically call it infiltration. Then after infiltration, it percolates through the formation. We call them percolation, and ultimately joins the water table. Water table means below the water table, the entire pore spaces are completely filled with water. And above that, this part, they are partially filled with water and partially with air. So this we call vagus zone or unsaturated zone. So this is interest for the person who deals with agriculture. This is interest for the person who deals with groundwater. So this is the water table. Now, as the rainwater infiltrates, or from any source the water infiltrates, naturally the water table will rise. And as you are extracting water, the water table will go down. So this is the basic stethoscope for groundwater scientists. That how the water level is coming up and water level is going down, it gives every information about the health of the aquifer. It sounds simple, but it is not that simple. There are further complicated things, but I am not going into that. But when the water level is there, because of the simple physics, because of the surface tension, through the pore spaces, the water will rise to some extent. Maybe it is half a meter, maybe it is few millimeters, depending on the grain size. So that is capillary zone. But in your well, in your dug well, in your bore well, whatever water level is getting you are, this is the water level. And in this water level, the pressure will be 1 atmospheric pressure. And this will tell that this is aquifer. This is not aquifer. This is aquifer. Now these are the two basic difference how the groundwater occurs in two broad type of rocks. One is loose sand. If you drill a well, even up to 1,000 meter in the Ganges clay, say in Patna, you will get all loose sandstone, loose sand. Now in loose sand, you can see these are white at the pore spaces which are filled with water. So the grains are uniform, the pore spaces are uniform, and the water is flowing at ease, groundwater is flowing. Okay, so this is the how the groundwater occurs and flows in soft rock in here. So if you drill a well here or a well here, it hardly matters, you will get water in this well as well as in this well. So no problem. That's why in alluvial area, in Indo-Gangetic plain or any alluvial area, if you drill wells, you will get water. Maybe the discharge will vary, say, but since they are connected, well connected, the pore spaces, you will get water. But see, in hard rock, like in the Rajgir Hills, you observe when next time go, there are fractures. You can see on the surface. The water percolates through these fractures and goes down. And it may go down even up to several kilometers and heats up and comes up. That is happening in Rajgir hot spring. But in by and large, it enters up to 400-450 meters below ground, and they are occurring fracture. Now you are drilling a well, say in your campus you are drilling a well. If you are lucky, if you can tap these fractures, you will get some water in your well. But if you are unlucky, if you cannot tap this fracture, you know your well will even die. And these fractures are unevenly, inhomogeneously distributed. That is the problem.
there are techniques to identify and locate these fractures, non-invasive techniques, like various geophysical techniques, like TEM, transient electromagnetic resistivity survey, helicon electromagnetic survey. There are many techniques. But another issue is fractures are there. These fractures can be dry also. So in spite of fracture, if they are dry, because their water holding capacity is less. So if they are dry already, if you put a well, you will not get water. So that is the basic difference between the soft rock and hard rock area. That's why the groundwater targeting and getting a good well in hard rock area is always challenging. Like in your Nalanda campus. Of course, in Nalanda campus, above this hard rock, about 20-30 meters soil is there, where sand, clay, various formations are there, where to some extent groundwater is there. Now, when you must understand the two basic things. There is two broad type of aquifer. I was telling that here, when the rainfall comes, it will percolate and join the water table. So it moves unhindered. Gradually goes down and joins the water table. And here the pressure is one atmospheric pressure. And it responds immediately. If the rainfall is there, water table will rise. But it can happen so that if you put a polythene sheet on this water table, what will happen? Rainfall will be there. It cannot go down and cannot join water table. So it's happening here. It is a formation. It's a particular type of rock. We call it clay. They hold water, but water cannot transmit. If there is a clay at the top, there will be rainfall, there will be source water, but it cannot percolate and join the sand body. So this is separated from the atmosphere. This we call confined aquifer. The two broad type, confined and unconfined. And there are semi-confined also in between. But the basic difference is, if you puncture this clay bed at the top, immediately the water level will go up and stand somewhere. We call them piezometric surface. Because the pressure on this aquifer is more than one atmospheric pressure. Because this is separating from the atmosphere, this layer. So this is confined and unconfined aquifer. Now, another interesting fact is, it's not that where you are, say here you are getting a unconfined aquifer which is exposed to the atmosphere, it will remain same as you are driving towards Rajgir town. Say here the aquifer is unconfined because it is connected to the atmosphere, and you are driving down here and gradually a clay bed comes and it becomes confined in this part. See the difference. So here if you drill a well, you will get a water level which will respond immediately to the monsoon. It will come up and down. But here, maybe 20 km away, your water level can even be above the surface. We call them artesian well. You must have seen in many parts. Why it is happening? Because of simple U-tip principle, the water level will try to reach the water level of this part. So that's why it tries. And it will give an autoflow well. And this is a typical autoflow well in the northern part of Bihar, in Madhubani district. And this area we call recharge area. Okay? And this recharge area from this autoflow well in Madhubani district is not in our country, it is in Nepal. So, like transboundary river, the issue of transboundary aquifer is also coming. We are receiving parliament question that because of the heavy development in Nepal, the water level in North Bihar and North UP is declining. Now this is a Bihar, now I am coming to Bihar. This is the Bihar, this is undivided Bihar, this is Jharkhand and this is Bihar. This is the Ganga, this is famous river Kosi. It's very famous. This river works, rather runs. Because in last 200 years it has shifted more than 150 kilometers. And again in 2008 flood, it tried to recapture his old course. But we have not allowed that river. Again we have bonded this, now the Kosi river is coming in this way. This is Ganga, this is Son, this is Gandak. And in this there are very few few examples in the entire world that in such a short area, so many mighty rivers are joining. If you see Kosi, I can assure you that you will be scared in the monsoon. If you see its discharge and span, this river. If you see the Ganga during monsoon in Patna from your flight, next time you see, it's at least 5 kilometers wide. And Soni is also like that. Gandak is also like that. So this has happened because of some geological reason. I'm not going into that. Why these rivers, all these rivers are joining here. And Patna is very, very wisely located capital. It's located all around the natural Delhi. It's a raised part in the floodplain. And the previously they call it Jal Durg because it was surrounded by mighty rivers in all sides. So it was difficult to enter. So Patna is located here, your Nalanda is located here. You can see the Rajgir Hills. Nalanda is located here. Nalanda district. Now the problem is, Professor Dev is here, he is a master in geology, but I will try to tell you something very preliminary fact. Why so much huge sediment is here, loose sediment? You will not believe here, the loose sediment may be of 5 kilometer thick, 5000 meter. The reason is, this Indian plate, this hard rock, they are going inside the Himalaya, below Tibet. And this was basically a trough. And it is gradually going down. And in say maybe after few million years, the entire India will go down below Tibet. And that is the reason the Himalaya is rising. And so much sediment is coming from Himalaya. It's mind-boggling. If you see the volume of sediment is coming from Himalaya, not only water. So huge sediment is coming, they are depositing, and this area is creating a suitable situation where huge sediments are coming and piling. So if you go towards north, the loose sediment thickness will increase and that will give you more and more good aquifer. But unfortunately, Nalanda is located in the hard, they are all hard rock area. Nalanda is located towards south. So in the beginning of the Nalanda, I will show you, the thickness of sediment may be 10 meter, but at the end, where you enter near Bhakti Arbu, thickness is more than 400 meter. In Patna town, it's about 700 to 800 meter thick sediment. This is a typical, we call it hydrogeological map of Bihar, where we can see where the good aquifers are here. You see the green colors are hard rock. Then we call it, these are the marginal alluvial area where the thickness of the loose sediments are not very much and groundwater potential is not very much. But even here, if you consider in respect to the hard rock, they are good, but not good in comparison to the huge aquifer system in the north and central part of Bihar. Okay, so as you are going towards north, the aquifer potentials are increasing. This is worst aquifer, then the sediment comes moderately, slightly good, they are excellent aquifers here. These are the water levels I was telling. That what is the water level? Because water level tells everything about aquifer, how they are getting exploited, whether they are fully recharged or not, except quality. These are the water levels of the aquifer. You know, central groundwater core, in India, I think I was telling that India is the largest water extractor in the world. And CGW have confirmed that the largest groundwater department also in the world, employing about 850 scientists in exclusively working on groundwater, because it needs geologists. We have about 200 odd engineers, then geophysicists, then chemists, and hydrometeorologists. So it's a big assembly. And one of the major duty is to monitor about 22,000 wells 4 times in a year throughout India. And our plan is to increase up to 70,000. Now, these are the well density in Bihar. They are measured, and on the basis of that, water level maps are regularly prepared, all through computer programming. Now we are going for, this is a programming called GEMS. We are going for eGEMS, so everything will be web-based. So on the basis of water levels, we measure in January, we measure in May, August and November. So different types of maps are prepared. It can show you the how the water levels are distributed, blue or less than 2 to 5, 5 to 10, more than 10. And this is pre-monsoon. That is the maximum water level possible in a year. And in last 15 days, I have visited two places. One is Jaisalmer, and 200 kilometers west of Jaisalmer, a place called Tanau. Water level was 60, 65 meters, something like that, 65 meter. And then in Jalgaon district of Maharashtra, where the water level is more than 50 meter. And you see the how blazed the Indo-Gangetic plain, so shallow water level and so potential aquifers. And this is the depth water level map of post-monsoon. So after monsoon, when the aquifers is recharged, what is the water level? You can say mostly in the state, it's 2 to 5 meter below ground. But a cozy situation. 2 to 5 meter, at some places 5 to 10 meter. This is another 5 to 10 meter, and this is less than 2 meter. And now I will try to tell you about the groundwater resource. The way we calculate the volume of water availability in a dam, in a barrage, so we also calculate the volume of groundwater available in aquifers. So there are two, and this is one of the robust way in India we are working on. There are 6,800 odd blocks in India. You know the blocks? The lowest administrative unit. All in all state, there is a committee headed by Principal Secretary Water Resource, and at least 2 to 3 months time they take for working out the resource, block-wise resource of entire India. Then they are deliberated in each state, they are getting approved, they get got approved from the states, they go to Delhi, and finally it is compiled and approved. There are in groundwater resource, there are two types of resources we classify. One is static, one is dynamic. Dynamic, I tell you that as the rainwater is entering, not only rainwater, there can be different sources. It can be rain, it can be seepage from tank, it can be return seepage from irrigation, or it can be flow through the aquifer also. It is coming in the aquifer from another area, maybe from another country, but it is adding to your resource. So you have to account for that also. So one part is every year the water level is, the water resource is building up. Now you see, this is the pre-monsoon water level, the deepest water level. This is the shallowest water level. So this volume of water is recharged every year, this volume of water. Now, how to work out this volume of water, because solid grains are also there. So there are detailed methodology to work out. So you work out the water table fluctuation from your well, and adopt that methodology, you can find out the dynamic resource. Like this resource is recharged every year. But you see, in the particularly in the alluvial area, huge resource available below that. That is called static resource. So this is the unconfined aquifer at the top, then a confining layer, then another aquifer, then another aquifer. So there can be number of aquifer. Say the Gangetic plain within 400 meter, you will get 4 aquifer system. They are separated from each aquifer. They have a separated flow regime. It's very interesting. And you will ask me how you will find that. There are isotopic technique. I think some isotope expert is also here. If you find out the age of groundwater also grows. So groundwater age can be 50 years. So rainfall comes, within 50 years you are extracting. So if you find out the age, you will get age of groundwater 50 years. But in this aquifer, if you are not extracting, this aquifer has got recharged from somewhere and they are here for thousands of years. So maybe you will get here the age of 3000, 4000 years. So in that way, you can get the age of groundwater maybe for 50,000 years, 60,000 years or so. So this is dynamic resource you can use safely environmentally for your use, and this is static resource. static resource as per the government policy, we are not supposed to use in a general condition. In case of emergency, we will use that. And this is the dynamic resource of Bihar. You see how rich the state is in dynamic groundwater resource. It is 29.34 billion cubic meter recharge. And there are some technical things that provisions for natural discharge, whatever it may be. 26 billion cubic meter is our dynamic groundwater resource of Bihar. So it is absolutely safe. And total India's dynamic resource is around 430 billion cubic meter. And you can see that 67% of it is coming from monsoon recharge and 12% is coming from non-monsoon recharge. So non-monsoon recharge are also sometimes are very important. And how the groundwater is extracted in Bihar, how they are used. The stage of groundwater development is 44.6%. This is the latest resource assessment, just 2014 the report published, carried out in 2011. So nearly 45% of our total dynamic resource we are using. Remaining we are not using. There are states in India where the stage of development is 250%, you will not believe. There are certain blocks where stage of development is 300%. So in Bihar we are using only 45% of total recharge, and main user is irrigation. Near more than 80% of the total extraction is for irrigation. And the problem of irrigation, managing the groundwater for irrigation is, as of today, nearly 30 million shallow tubers are working in India. Somebody said 27, somebody said 32, somebody said 30 million shallow tubers, and mostly they are in the private hand. Some of them are 40 feet deep, some of them are 400 meter deep. So there is no control in that, and it is accelerating, the extraction is accelerating like anything, and government is trying to regulate it, but it's a very difficult task politically also. And if you see the quality of Bihar, the groundwater in Bihar, it is by and large potable and fit for irrigation. We mainly see two aspects, whether it is fit for irrigation, there are certain criteria, and whether it is fit for drinking. So it's by and large fit and very good quality. However, quality concerns which are coming is arsenic, fluoride, iron, zinc, etc. and nitrate. And arsenic, fluoride, iron, zinc, they are all geogenic, that is coming from rock water interaction. We are not contributing to that. Maybe we are triggering that, but not directly contributing. But nitrate contamination we are contributing through our overuse of fertilizer. Now, arsenic is, we all know, whenever arsenic contamination comes, we discuss about Bangladesh and West Bengal, but Bihar is now not behind, and UP also. These are the arsenic affected areas in Bihar, and you can see that they are around the Ganga, 57 blocks in 15 districts are affected, and 9 million people, they are residing in the risk zone. In arsenic contamination, and arsenic is a serious issue, and you all know that now it is confirmed that Napoleon Bonaparte was poisoned with arsenic. And this is a typical arsenic affected person in Bhojpur district, and this is a typical satellite imagery how the arsenic contaminated area looks like. This is the Ganga is flowing, meandering heavily. These are the meander scars, cutoff channel, typical gadgetic plane. Next time when you fly, you try to see these things. And they are all arsenic contaminated villages are located. And interesting part is, there are many unanswered questions in Bihar, which are much more interesting than Bangladesh and West Bengal. Why the arsenic contaminated areas are confined along the both banks of the Ganga? Why they are not in Kosi? Why they are not in Ganga